This is the One Piece Podcast, episode 565 for the week of Sunday, April 14th, 2019. My name is Zach.
And my name is Ed.
And my name is Steve.
And on today's show, very special guest, he is the translator for One Piece and Shonen Jump and Manga Plus. We have Stephen Paul with us. How's it going, Stephen?
It's going very good. I have done my spring cleaning for the year, so sorry, winter, you are not coming. You're going. Get out.
I mean,
you live in San Diego. It snowed like 4 inches here today.
We also have on the show from Viz, the app guy, the media guy. I don't have media your title guy in front of me for some reason. Jeff Ruberg's back. How's it going, Jeff?
Hey, good to be on. I don't know my own title either, so just person who works at Viz.
I mean, you've been the like, what's the DJ, I guess, for the Shonen Jump podcast? I
don't know. Yeah, what's yeah. Producer. Been filling in with recording for a couple weeks in a row recently, but my main job is to work on the iOS and Android apps for the Viz app, the Shonen Jump app, and then occasionally filling in some podcast stuff I've been doing recently. Yeah,
I do want to say I think they've gotten so damn intuitive. I'm very, very happy with everything you've done with them. Like even being able to pick up where you left off and all that stuff is great. So
yeah,
I want to give you thanks. Props. And I assume that's all you.
I don't take all the credit. I have a good team that I'm working with. It's not just me. Basically, like before, I was the only one working on them, but there's a lot more attention on them now, and there's a lot more to go. But it's exciting times. So,
and of course, last but not least, we also have Anime News Network reviewer for JoJo's Bizarre Adventure: Golden Wind, as well as One Piece and. I think Dragon Ball Super hasn't been going on for a while. And Black Clover. Am I missing anything? Sam Leach?
My Hero Academia.
That's all of them, though, right?
Bleach has really not been on the air for a while.
Did I say Bleach?
World
say Bleach?
Trigger. I thought you
were Black Clover, I thought I said. If I did.
You like Black Clover, Bleach.
Check the tape.
Bo-bo-bo. Hitman Reborn.
Bokuben.
I'm clearly not in my right mind today already, so this is going to bode well. This week we have a manga recap. You see, doing great here. keep rolling. For chapter 939, The Old Leopard Never Forgets the Way. I'm looking forward to an explanation of that title when we get into the manga. Sam, we also have an anime episode as we get deeper into the Reverie stuff here.
Yeah, we do. We have episode 880, Sabo Goes Into Action. All the captains of the Revolutionary Army appear.
Actually, Sabo isn't in much action at all this episode.
Yeah, he doesn't do much at all. He's a character people know.
He's literally laying in a field of flowers.
thank you, Joe Montaigne, for that explanation.
You know, you call him, they call the episode Sabo in Action, but clearly Sabo is not in action.
Okay.
So, yeah,
before we get into that and some piece together and a lot more, this has been a really exciting week. If you like trailers, not just for Star Wars, but also for One Piece Stampede, we got a new poster. We got a new teaser trailer showing off how every single secondary and tertiary character in One Piece will be in this movie. What did you guys think of those since those came out earlier this week?
Art looks nice.
Anyone else?
It got me pretty pumped because it looks like I should have looked this up, but it might be the same director that from it. Has it been the same film director since Filmsy?
I don't think so.
Overall director? I don't think so.
No. But anyway, like that director went on to work on Dragon Ball Super, Broly. And this movie looks like that movie. And if that's any indication, this is going to be one pretty looking movie.
Yeah. So anyway, this guy is Takashi Otsuka, who's directing this. And he was a unit director on Film Gold. He directed also the episode of East Blue.
That was a good looking special.
Yeah. It was a good special, yeah.
Cool. So that's out. Excited to see more about that. We also have some news regarding the worldwide release of that. Nothing yet about the United States, but we had just announced, I think this was a deal, who said that One Piece Stampede will be coming out in Singapore, Malaysia, Brunei, Indonesia, and the Philippines.
It's a courtesy of Odex, if anyone remembers the old Odex dub from the early days of One Piece.
I do not. Yeah. Is it like the green? Was it the DBZ one? I think that was.
Well, yeah, it's like this. It's like an English language Southeast Asian dub, essentially.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah. It's not great. I mean,
people listen to us for our brutal honesty, I think. Yeah, that's the main reason people listen to us. There's also, I in merchandise news, Kelly was posting this, and it's super cool. What volume is that? The Fishman Island volume, where it's the whole crew basically showing off their power. 64, thank you. They have figures for each of them, and it looks really cool, in my opinion.
I pre-ordered all of them.
Of course.
Mm-mm. And both shoppers, and this is how crazy I was. I pre-ordered two Robins.
Sir, that's right. You need both of them.
You need both. Yeah. Otherwise that doesn't work. it's not accurate.
They got me.
Yeah.
I think that's all of,
why news. Did I buy them, Zach? I don't know where I'm going to put them.
I was going to ask you that question, but I decided to kind of let that go. But
no, look, I'm having a crisis here.
If you want to have a One Piece merchandise intervention, this is not the right place. On that note, Steve, good luck with the remaining desk space that you have as we get into the manga.
Ooh.
This is the manga recap for chapter 939, The Old Leopard Never Forgets the Way. And before we get into an explanation as to that, remember, you could read this chapter the same exact time it comes out in Japan on shonenjump.viz.com, or if you are global and not in the United States, you could read it at Manga Plus. Please do. This was the first week where I had people trying to spoil me since the legal free global release thing started. I'm like, how? Like,
really, just to spoil you, or just because they couldn't help them?
Well, I had One Piece together who couldn't help themselves, and then one guy who's like, I don't care, I'm going to read it the other way anyway. It's like, why? There's no explanation at this point. So, yeah, get on board. Steve, what is going on with the title?
Me?
Steven. Not my day-to-day. Zach, we've discussed this.
As you know, a leopard never forgets. So naturally, an old leopard would never forget
Steven,
their way.
Steven, can you tell Steve to shut up, please? Steven, what is the title here?
Ed, can you tell Zach that I'm not listening to him? So the title here. This is a tricky one. It's a play on words. There's a saying in Japanese that it literally translates to an old horse never forgets the way. And, you know, in a literal sense, that means like if you're riding somewhere and you don't know where you are, when you're with an old horse, like an old pack horse, you just let them walk and they will get you back to the path where you're supposed to be, because you know it's an old horse, like they've done this before, they know where the path is even if you don't. That would be a literal meaning, but the figurative meaning, the way that people use it, is in the sense of when someone is a veteran who has a lot of experience, you can generally rely on them, like their instincts will be right because of the experience that they have. That they know what they're doing, or they will remember how to do it. And so the wordplay comes in here because Oda replaced the word horse with the word leopard. Leopard happens to be pronounced hyo in Japanese. So he's clearly referring to old man hyo, but he uses the kanji for leopard. So it's kind of interesting. It's kind of a weird thing where it's a very kind of like I guess visual, kind of poetic sounding statement, and especially when you have the animal in there, but he is kind of, you know, referring to old man Hyo. And so I wasn't going to like, you know, replace it with like the old man Hyo never forgets the way or something like that, because that would be a little on the nose. But
you could lead a leopard to water.
Yeah. So yeah, I don't know. And who knows? Like, Oda may decide in the future at some point to like reveal his, you know, like Hyogoro, his true proper name, spelling it with the leopard kanji or something. You know, Oda likes to do stuff like that where he gives, you know, you learn several different names or titles or whatnot for the same character. So that's kind of what he's going for here, which, as we'll find out, is representative of what happens in this chapter.
So I'm trying to think. Yes, Steve.
You know, you could tune a piano, but you can't tune an old leopard. So
that's exactly what it means.
That's, yeah. You can't.
I've heard that so many times.
I'm trying to think of an animal that starts with Hyo, and the closest I could think of is the old hippopotamus never forgets the way.
That's the old horse.
Oh, that's much better. That's much better. So maybe next time, Stephen. Ed, what's going on the front page here?
We're going under the sea for a crab haircut.
That's your solution under everything, the Ed. Sea.
There we go.
That's your solution to everything, Ed. It's not going to happen.
Yes, this is Jinbei getting a haircut on the seafloor from a spider crab by Hiu M.
So for those wondering what happened to Jinbei, he needed to stop to get a haircut at the barber.
He's getting his fade touched up.
His top knot.
Is he getting his top knot cut off? That's so wrong.
He's also really, first off, that looks like a great barber's chair. Second off, why is Jinbei so into this? What is happening?
He's very happy. I don't know.
He's third of
so,
all.
I've never seen Jinbei that happy.
Third of all, why the hell would you cut your hair when it's soaking wet in the ocean?
No, you have to. Don't have much left.
But. And why would you trust a barber that has a hat covering their own hair?
That's the big problem.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you know, did you ever think about like really, like how does Frankie work? I mean, he's a cyborg that runs on cola, please.
This is definitely.
Jinbei's sweet robe there with like car wheels on it.
Yes.
It's the wacky race.
Exactly.
Like lemon slices.
No. You're thinking of Miss Valentine.
Yeah.
Okay. We're pretty loopy this episode apparently already, so maybe we should just get into the chapter, Ed.
Okay. So back in the snow-covered cabin, Zoro's reacting. Momonosuke's little sister? As he like chokes on his breath there. And she says, oh, I knew it. I'm so glad I summoned the courage to reveal that. It was a bit of a gamble on my part. So you know who my brother is? And she's very excitedly coming up to Zoro. And as he says, oh, wait, hang on. I need to sort the facts in my head. And she says, so he must still be alive. With all the rumors floating around the return of the Kozuki clan, when I saw a mighty and kind-hearted samurai from abroad, I wondered, maybe he's working with my brother. And she's like shaking her head back and forth, like concerned and like a happy face or like, oh, unless you're an enemy who's trying to track him down. Ah. Yeah, and Zoro finally gets a word in. He says, no, I'm on his side. I can tell you that much. Oh, thank goodness. Big gas. Big whew from her. And Kinemon and Kanjuro and Raizo and Kiku Nojo. Which that is. Mm.
Yeah, the weird part about that is... Kiku no Jo is obviously it's referring to Okiku, but that's a new, again, a new form of the name that we have not seen before. And as far as I can tell, I believe that is, well, first of all, I believe there is a like a Rakugo, or maybe it's a Kabuki actor nowadays whose stage name is Kiku no Jo. So Oda might be, you know, making a bit of a play on that. But also, like, I believe that is generally a male name.
I was gonna say that's
the ending at least part, the no Jo. And I think I read somewhere, I believe I saw a comment saying that it was often also a name for, like, you know, in the traditionally, Kabuki, there are no female actors. That's one of the reasons why, like, the Takarazuka, like, all-female review is kind of notable, because the traditional arts, stage arts in Japan, they did not have any women actors. And so the Nojo, apparently, according to this comment I said, I can't actually confirm this, was often like the actors who played female parts. So it does kind of, again, sort of muddy the waters again, as far as like, okay, is Okiku, is she like, is this a man who is acting like a woman, or is this a woman who is, you know, sort of being one of the guys? It's kind of hard to tell.
Or what is it, the, like an Ivankov thing going on?
Right. Yeah. So
it's One Piece. You never know.
The eternal really question. Don't. Yes.
Yeah. Well, it won't be that eternal. I'm sure we'll figure it out.
So that Joe and Kikino Joe, it's not the kanji for woman.
No, it's not. Like Ojo-san. It's not that.
I thought it was the girl of Kiku, and I was like, oh, that's on the nose. But I guess if it's trying to be a more male name, that's the opposite of what I thought.
Well, maybe it's a pun too. You know, maybe he's trying to trick you. It's a red herring. If it means woman to girl or anyway, go ahead, Ed.
Okay. So Zoro is very deadpan here, and he also imagines Momonosuke as her face, which I'd rather not see, but it's funny looking. So he's like, I'm getting the picture now. Momo traveled 20 years ahead in time, so he's still 8 years old. Well, his little sister's now 26. And he points at
the I just wanna note that Zoro must have heard this story before, right? Did they mention that?
Because he probably wasn't there. Heard it before.
Yeah, he wasn't there when they.
Yeah, yeah, I don't remember who was there for that explanation.
All I know is Zoro was not, because Zoro has not re-met a lot of the crew that has returned after Whole Cake Island.
Zoro mentioned that he knew about the Kozuki tribe being quote unquote dead, because when they were talking about the about the gravestones or the whatever the graves.
Oh yeah. He said something like
Zoro and Law sounded like they knew what was up, and it was Luffy who was about to learn.
They've been in Wano for a while. I'm assuming they've had this discussion by this point. But yeah, go ahead, right. Ed. Sorry to interrupt.
So he continues and he points at Otoko and says, and she's allowed to be hearing all this? And she's like, yeah, it's fine. I already know. Big Sis and me made it our special secret. And Murasaki continues, Otoko is one of the few friends I have who knows my true nature. It's her cheeriness that helps me get through the day. 20 years ago, I was as young as she is now, but I'll never forget what happened that terrible day. Before my eyes, my brother and the others simply vanished among the roaring flames. It was the same day that I lost my father, Odin, as well as my mother. And in the background, we get just the burning Odin castle. It's it's pretty
sad. Yeah, it's a little bit of a weird sentence construction there, where she's like, yeah, it's the day that I lost my father. And then there was my mother, too. just throwing it in a secondary way.
Well, you know, her mother isn't the main character of that flashback.
Apparently not. Yeah.
No. And she
I guess this too, I didn't really consider this until this point, but I guess this would confirm too that Otoko, when she says Big Sis, she must be referring to her in the familiar way, not in the family way. It's just Nei-san or Oji-san, that sort of.
Seems like she was just a girl who was in the where she was working.
Pleasure house, yeah.
Right.
Well, yeah. Anyway, so we continue and says that she continues to say, in a single day, she has lost everything. And so that the idea that my brother would just come back 20 years later was a fleeting hope and offered me little solace. And that she had lost the will to go on. And Zoro asks, you weren't allowed to jump into the future with him? And, Hyogo, that's the her real quote unquote name, right?
Hiyori.
Who's Hyogo? Is old man Hyo?
Yogoro.
Hyogoro. I don't know. It's all we've discussed names in Wano and how confusing they all. Hiyori / Nakumadasaki says, apparently it was either Momonosuke or me. And that way, if something happened to one of us, the Kozuki blood might still live on. And Zoro very correctly notes that that is pretty cruel. And she just ignores that thought and says, well, one of my father's vassals, Kawamatsu the Kappa, patiently supported and cared for me and raised her from a child on. And Zoro also rightfully is like, a Kappa? And she says, yeah, it's hard to believe he's a river imp, but he's very proud of it. So anyway, she goes on with this story about Kawamatsu and says, the day that the castle was burned, they were surrounded by enemies on all sides, but Kawamatsu helped her escape through the moat undetected. And we see Kawamatsu here going through the water, presumably carrying Hiyori, and then entertaining her as he says, watch me, watch my kappa dance, princess. And I assume it's a very entertaining dance.
Allow me to do the dance of joy, princess.
It's a big week for the Kappas.
That new show.
Yeah, there's that new Ikuhara show.
All over my head. And
it's very good, but it's hopefully the Kappas in this manga don't get as explicit. There's a lot of butt imagery in that show.
So as Kawamatsu's doing his kappa dance, of course Hiyori also wants to do the dance, and he says, only I may dance. That didn't happen. That was a joke targeted only at Steve.
I just think it's funny that he's like, oh, the princess is so devastated, I must cheer her up by dancing. She's like, oh, wow, that's so sweet. I'll dance too. No, you stop.
Only kappas may dance.
Yeah, this is our dance. You don't have to do dance.
Anyway, he's cheering her up, and she seems to be getting cheered up and says he would give what food he could find, and then we go back into the flashback, and Kawamatsu's like, yeah, I've had an upset stomach, but I did spot this delicious grilled fish swimming in the river. Let's be fair, though. He probably wasn't grilled when he was swimming in the river. And says, I've already had my meal for the day. So obviously, you know, being charitable to a little girl who has lost literally everything. And so you see her being cute and smiling and laughing. And Zora's like, so where is this guy now? If only us as the readers had any idea. Hiyori says they were separated when she was around 13 years old. So she's what, 23?
26. She said so earlier in the chapter.
Right, I just don't remember. And she goes on and says, but Kawamatsu was a very powerful samurai. I'm sure that wherever he is waiting for the day of the great battle. Oh, how I wish to see him again.
Her right hand is drawn very round.
Also, look at Toko. It's like the confused Sanji picture where he's just like.
To be fair, Toko always looks horrifying. That's just her design.
She kind of does. Yeah.
I didn't even realize that was a hand. I thought that was just part of her dress.
her right hand. Yeah. That is like, remember Oda used to be very self-conscious about his hand drawing? He looks like
she's been attacked by Khalifa. It looks like she's been attacked by Khalifa's.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
You know what? If someone in SBS asks, I bet you that's what he answers. Khalifa came by and just did the slip for you there.
Zoro's drinking through this entire scene.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, well, of course.
I wanted to point out one other thing, too, and this is just me. I'm going to kind of go out on a limb here and wonder if this is what's going on. But, like, the fact, because, you know, we've had this, like, sort of long, slow reveal of what's up with Kawamatsu where, you know, like, we haven't seen him, and then he does the kappa laugh, and here she's saying that he is a kappa, but we're still kind of seeing him shrouded in shadow. And I get this feeling that, like, when she says, oh, it's hard to believe that he really is one of these river imps, but he's really proud of it. I wonder if we're going to like see him. And you know how like kappas have like sort of a duck bill thing. If he's just like a mask. Dude. Yeah. He's just a dude with like the little duck bill on a string, like around his face.
Or the stupid like teeth, the like the guy from kappas.
Yeah.
I'm assuming like he is a kappa. Yeah.
I mean, I want him to be a kappa, but I think he could be setting up a joke here, which would be pretty funny too.
Well, the fact that he goes under, I'm assuming Kappas are more able to last underwater longer because, you know, he's showing off his prowess underwater here. Well, I don't know.
He can just be like, he's just really good at holding his breath.
Sam, mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Okay, we turn the page. Kyori is saying, really? So Doggy and Kitty are with you too? But I heard they were dead. Zoro says, well, Cat Viper might not actually be in Wano yet, but yeah, pretty much. What are you doing? And Kyori's making this really funny face where she's like sucking her lips in. She's like trying not to cry. She's like, I'm just so happy, but I won't cry. I'm the daughter of a samurai. And she's still making that face, but Otoko is busting the gut. You're so funny, big sis. And then Zoro goes on to detail. The only ones we know about are the six and Momonosuke. We see a little diagram of the Akazai Nine, the ones who we know. Kinemon, Kondoro, Raizu, Okiku, Dogstorm, Cat Viper. I haven't met the other three yet.
I did not know Dogstorm and Cat Viper were part of the Akazai Nine. Is that?
I think we're learning that now.
Yeah, okay. I just want to make sure. Yeah.
It's interesting. Kyori says, the others are Kawamatsu, who I just described, and then Denjiro and Ashura Doji. And Ashura Doji is Sentomaru. Not Sentomaru. What's his name? Shutenmaru. Yeah. And then we haven't met Denjiro yet, have we?
No, that's the one still totally up in the air.
Have we gotten any information about anyone named Denjiro at this point? I just forget because of the amount of names.
No, he's been referenced like in the same breath as like Kawamatsu and Ashura Doji like this, but we still have not seen him specifically.
All right, so we know of two of these three remaining ones. So I'm wondering what is going. Okay, we'll talk about that at the end, I'm sure. Go ahead.
Yeah, I don't know where any of them are or if they're still alive and well, but the entire capital is in an uproar over this symbol now, so I am certain that they will appear. Zoro is saying, while having the information spreading out in the open feels like a shortcut to our goal, it's clearly a bad thing that the actual meeting place is known and that our comrades are getting arrested. Things are looking dicey. And then he just lays down, but can't do anything about that. We don't need every last guy trying to steer the ship at the same time, so I'm going to stop worrying about this and take a nap. That's the spirit, Sir Zoro Juro. For now, just relax and heal up. Go back to sleep. And then Otoko and Hiyori they're continuing to yap in the background as Zoro's trying to get some sleep. Yay, my brother is alive, Otoko! And Zoro is thinking to himself, how am I supposed to sleep while you're yapping over there? And Kyori is just like completely lost in thought now. She's really excited to meet her brother again, but he's only 8. How mysterious that is. They'll all be just as I remember them. I wonder what will happen when I see them. Maybe it's best if I don't see them before the battle. It wouldn't be right to throw cold water on a warrior's fight. Right, Otoko? And then Z's, because Otoko, as we can see in the panel before, Otoko is out cold as well.
And Zoro
found he found a way to fall asleep somehow.
Well, I'm going to say, Zoro has slept through everything in the past. Yeah. I mean, this is obviously a good gag from Oda. I'm just assuming right after he thought that, he just fell right asleep.
Yeah. There's no time lapse at all between these panels.
They
this
don't show also, any, so yeah.
Repeating what like Momonosuke was saying about how he didn't want to see his sister until the battle was over. The catharsis is supposed to come like at the very, very end. Like it's kind of like romantic that they kind of hold off this meeting until everything's said and done, or like something's really unexpected is going to go down and they're going to like have to meet early or something.
Yeah, and it seems like she's just like a chatterbox. She talks like a mile a minute. No one can get a word in.
Yeah, she's a lot different than
Kamurasaki.
I'm losing my brain today. Jeff.
All right, so turning the page, we're switching to the Rasetsu Town Flower Capital. And, tying into Star Wars Celebration Week, they're throwing people in the cages. And again, they're rebel scum. and they're throwing them in, yelling at them, you scheming traitors. What do we have a name for the tall-headed guy? tall forehead.
Oh, yeah, it's yeah,
it's right there.
What is it?
Fukurokuju.
Fukurokuju. Oh, yeah, yeah, Fukurokuju. So he says your little stunt's already been revealed. You failed. He's showing the picture of the tattoo. And the people in the cage, whose names I also forget. If they've been characters.
I don't
characters.
Know if we were.
No, we never got names.
Okay.
They've all talked, yeah.
Yeah, we have the tattoos. The guy on the right with the He-Man hair was the one who was like, oh, I want to fight even if I don't have a weapon.
And in the other panel is the Buddha guy. Like, we saw these guys talking with Kinemon and crew. So they're definitely lying when they say they don't know what's going on. Yeah.
Yeah, so to their lying, they're shouting, wait, Fukurokuju, what is it about these tattoos that makes you think we're traitors? They're just a fashion statement once. We have nothing to do with any kind of rebellion. Fukurokuju is like, silence, how do you explain the symbolic image? You're here by the shogun's own edict, so pipe down. And then we get this big spread showing the public, Rasazu prisoners' quarters, public cells. This is what happens to those who defy Shogun Orochi and Lord Kaido. Never expected we would arrest so many at once. Behold you onlookers. And then we see the ebbing of everyone watching this elaborate display. Behold their foolish faces. It's quite an arresting sight. There's still more to come. And then everyone reflecting in the cage. So this is the Buddha guy.
I think this is just Beppo talking.
That's Beppo.
Oh, this is all Beppo. Oh, yeah. Okay, yeah. This is a bad situation. I hope they don't think we spilled the beans. And then Beppo lying there. Is he... He's all beat up, but is he bleeding? He's not in a good place. Captain will believe in us.
Very cute.
He's missing a chunk of his ear.
Oh yeah. No!
Wow, that's not good.
Oof.
Yeah. So this definitely rules out that it wasn't Beppo and Penguin and Shachi. Not that we necessarily suspected it was, but that definitely rules them out as the ones who let slip the secret.
This whole spread feels very Kurosawa.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I know what you mean. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's he does a lot of that, like setting the scene kind of. I don't know if that is a good way to describe it, but like, meanwhile, this is what's happening. Yeah, I know what you mean.
I like that we're seeing a lot of these like background characters again, he's kind of reusing their images. Like the guy with the silky hair and the eye scar. I really like that. That guy's design from the earlier chapter, and the one next to him with the like the crazy facial hair, that's a really cool look too.
I mean, it's also
does he have a bonsai tree on his head above his hair?
Oh, the middle one.
Oh, the guy in the middle. Yeah.
Yeah.
I did not notice that. That's amazing. Awesome. I do want to say that like having these secondary and tertiary and like very minor characters involved like this does make the stakes of this like larger, I think. So when we see this eventual battle and we see all these people we recognize like Banzai Man, it'll definitely kind of raise the stakes the Banzai.
Yeah, I feel like we're being set up for, you know, like the other people in the cell with the heart pirates, like they're going to have to like choose if they, you know, believe in them or not.
I thought they just set fire to the whole place. I mean, I don't know if this is like an Austin Powers thing where it's like, okay, now we'll bring in the sharks with laser beams attached to their heads and then close the curtain.
We couldn't afford that.
Steve.
So, anywho, at the excavation labor camp, Udon, we hear the crowd roar as we see something going on in the Thunderdome. Get him, Alpaca Man, Maduro Man, as we see the Kappa dude just thinking in ellipses. He says, like, I wish I could sumo wrestle too, as he hears the roar of the crowd in the distance. Love those two panels of a heavy use of blacks, but the return of Alpaca Man, Alpacachino.
Yeah.
And I assume this is his laugh, his pa ka 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 ka. He laughs like an alpaca Popeye, I guess. And he spits because he's not a gentleman. And
he's an alpaca gentleman. And those gentlemen spit.
Sure, Zach. Now we get this other guy who's like, you're done for now, boys. These are sea prism stone bullets only made in Wano.
And we were like, come on, Medulla man, put the pistols away. And Luffy's like, what? And Armadillo? As we get an introduction to one of the gifters, Medulla man, the armadillo smile fruit.
I love that.
I love that he shortened the name to Medulla man. It's so good. It's such a punchy name.
Yet he still has the letter A on his belt buckle.
Well, just so you could spell the rest of it out with his belt buckle. Oh, Armadillo man. Now
no, he's not Armadillo man. He's a Medulla man.
Oh, there must be other Medulla men.
He just wants to be first in the phone book.
He still looks like a freaking primate here, a freaking Medulla gorilla over here. Jeez.
Don't they have like a Mandrillo? Isn't that the name?
Mandrillo.
And he's wearing the thing that in that one episode of Pokemon when there's the trainer. It's like early on where the trainer's kind of abusing a Sandshrew.
But Medulla man, get back in the water. Don't get back in the water. You'll obviously drown. But the crowd is like, you're going to end the match too fast. That's no fun. These guys don't want a squash match. They want a Broadway. They want 5 stars at least. And Medulla man's like, shut up. This is an execution. And
he's so pissed.
Yeah. And Queen says, oh, are these guys blind or something? It's like, what makes them think this is over? that's some good Wano food right there.
Wait, what is he eating that same food?
It's the Oshiduko, yeah.
Oshiduko, yeah.
What is that again?
Oshiduko, that's the red bean pudding like paste. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, so Big Mom's after. She's not, yep. Yeah.
So. Are you eating my Oshiduko? Go ahead.
So Luffy grins and says, hey, Gramps, head to the right. Duck, then jump. He always like, huh? Head to the right as he starts dashing. And then that's when Medulla man, pew, pew, starts firing his bullets in that direction. And patuh, as Alpaca man spits. And
that would have been the really bad part there. Let's be honest. Yeah. Gun, Lort. Whatever.
And then instructed to duck.
A beautiful face. Oh, that.
Yeah.
Oh, wait. Is that Patu? That Patu is in English in the Japanese. Right?
No.
Because we didn't. Oh, did we touch? Oh, that was touched up. I mean, that was a.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
I got excited. I thought Oda wrote a Patu.
Maybe the exclamation points were probably from Oda, but the Patu is just font.
Now I'm sad.
But. Just to wrap up this page, it's clearly Luffy's using his haki to give Hiyo instructions. You know, slide to the left, slide to the right, cha 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 now, crisscross.
Oh god, it's like every wedding I've ever been to.
Cha 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 now.
Wait, do you think that guy just has observation haki? Maybe that's what it is.
I know. Why don't you try it in a fight next time, Zach? I have money. And then,
next time I'm in Taekwondo. Next time I'm in Taekwondo, I'm just gonna do slide to the right. where are we, Steve? Sam.
All right. We turn the page, and the alpaca man is saying, "Take this," and he's slicing with his sword. And Hiyo is saying he's following Luffy's instructions, and then jump, and he headbutts the alpaca right under the chin. No way! Did you see how the nimble old man Hiyo looked just now? Nice one, Gramps! And the alpaca man is on the ground.
Wait, I want to note in this panel, Luffy's giving him the thumbs up and there are bullets on either side of Luffy's arm. Which is so badass. I love Luffy. He's such a good main character. You just forget, and then you see that. Go ahead.
And then Hiyo is asking, what was that? It was like he saw the future. And Luffy is continuing to tell him what to do.
Isn't that a line from something, too? It's like he saw the future. Anyway, go ahead.
Next, go left. And then he goes left, and now Alpaca Man just barely misses him. Enough of this. Left. Medulla Man is shooting his bullets, and Luffy's dodging. We've seen Luffy do stuff. Oh, we saw Luffy doing this with the in the sumo match. It's kind of like arms crossed, like hopping around.
Yeah, but this is definitely the first we saw him predicting moves in this kind of way, right?
Well, to be fair, these guys are idiots, so
yeah,
can't be that hard.
Yeah, that's true.
I mean, he's been dodging bullets ever since the time skip.
Well, no, now he's using his like super observation.
Super cool observation.
I mean, it's really effective Katakuri. When he's not fighting Katakuri, who knows what he's doing. Like,
yeah,
these guys are too stupid to be take seriously.
Are you calling Medillo Man stupid?
Yes, stupid okay. Medillo Man.
What's up with him? Why can't I hit him? And Luffy's grabbed him. Hop. That's not going to work. Arma defense. And he.
That's a great name that I just. Oh my god, I love it.
Thank you.
So, okay, what's going on here? So the armadillo on the guy's head is like rolling around his face.
Yeah, yeah, I guess that's like him? I guess that's like the armadillo's head and hands coming out of the shell on his back, maybe.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's true because there's. But yeah.
But it only covers his head.
Because he's covers usually
his
bald
mouth a little bit. Yeah.
Well, I mean, also with these smile users, the animal is still there. It's just although the alpaca man is a very confusing thing going on there. I'm not quite sure.
Yeah.
Maybe there's another humanoid dude inside the alpaca man somewhere else that's gonna.
Oh my god, poor guy! I'm living inside an alpaca neck.
And Luffy, he puts his defense up, but Luffy doesn't. His punch doesn't even go all the way. He stops himself. An armadillo man opens his eyes like, huh? And Luffy, he's off to the side, just talking to himself like, no, that's not right. That's not. That's just normal armament hockey. Huh? Didn't he punch me?
I'm confused by the bing. Yeah. What was the bing sound effect?
The bing isn't stopping. It's like, bing.
Okay.
Yeah. So on the next page, Hyo is asking for directions as Alpaca Man busts out with alpaca fencing. Now, if you're not clear about how alpaca fencing works, it's where I swing my swords around like this. And if you get hit, that's your own fault. Luffy, this is great. Luffy's just like, stay there. He's like, what? And then instantly, Luffy is behind Hyo and he grabs him by the arms and then does some acrobatic flips. He rolls out of the way and you can see in the background like Alpaca Man just like blazing past. Cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha. And Luffy says, it'll be easier this way. And Hyo, true to character, is like, you know, protesting like, no, you can't let me be a burden. You have to put me down. And Luffy says, no, the heavier, the better. It's good training, which, again, fitting with the kind of theme of this this little sumo wrestle arc here. And Hyo is like, what? I mean, we're prisoners. They're executing us. Like, it's this whole sick thing. And you're training? You keep holding back your punches and saying, that's not right. What are you doing? And Luffy's like, I'm not trying to hold back at the last second. I'm trying to swing and hit them without actually touching them because it feels like I might be able to destroy those tough scales of Kaido's that way, but I won't know until I can actually do it. And he recalls some flashback scenes that he has seen before of Rayleigh doing it. And Sentomaru doing it back. Was that in Shabandi or was that in Marineford?
It was Shabandi.
No, that was on Ruskina.
Okay. No. Rayleigh one was Ruskina.
Oh, Sentomaru. Yeah.
Sentomaru.
Rayleigh was on.
And it's funny because I don't. It's really hard to tell what Oda planned and what Oda is kind of
right,
retconning, right. Because. I think at the time we were just like, oh, this is just regular armament hockey, but he didn't draw black at the time. But now it seems that, and I'm not sure because when Rayleigh did a Ruskina, I assume by that point Oda had some sort of conceit as to what armament hockey would look like. So I'm super curious if like this is an element of hockey that Oda had in mind in some way at that point. It's a really good question. Yeah, I'm not sure.
Yeah,
go ahead.
Stuff
yeah.
to say.
Yeah.
And Hyo is like, this hockey must be a foreign concept, which is an odd thing to hear because haki being a Japanese word, and here we are in One Piece's Japan. And he's like, this mysterious haki sounds foreign to me. But he goes on to explain as Luffy continues to dodge.
Do they have haki teams in Japan? Go ahead.
I think they do. And apologies. He explains that, yes, in Wano 2, we know about an invisible power that stems from the body and can be infused with the blade. So talking about another use of haki, a good katana will cut through steel when you want it to, and it will not break a sheet of paper if you do not wish it so, all according to the desire of the swordsman. And that goes back to...
I've heard the speech before.
Yeah, when did we see that flash? Was that in Alabasta before... Zoro cuts steel because he's remembering. Yeah,
that's that whole episode with him and Mr. One. Like that's like his master told him a long time ago.
Right.
I'm gonna pull Koshiro. Up.
Yeah. When he says like, "Oh, watch this," and then he whacks the sword against the paper, and Zoro's like, "You didn't do anything."
That was a really cool scene. That's a really great episode, actually. Didn't I?
And so Hyo continues, I was known as the Mighty Blade in the past, and I do not know if I can properly teach it, but take a look for yourself. So we got a couple things here where he is referring to what seems to be another epithet for himself as the Mighty Blade. And and now we see the old Hyo is reaching back and remembering the way, if you will.
Yep. So he charges at Alpaca Man, and he says, "Luke, give me your directions." And Luke says, he's going to swing down his right-hand sword hard, and Alpaca Man's like, huh? So he swings, and Hyo dodges, and his face is turning black, and Alpaca Man has this look of great concentration on his face, which is kind of cute, actually. Luffy has shocked on his face, and we see Hyo's black hand sort of projecting power into Alpaca Man's neck. Like, it's almost like what Sabo's Dragon Claw attack looks like.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Pretty similar.
It's kind of interesting, too, that, like, if it wasn't for the specific way that he draws it with all the white space around it, there's really no way to tell that he's actually not touching him. Mm-hmm. You know, it just looks like he's punching him.
Yeah. And Luffy's like, he's shocked. You knocked him back. And Queen is pretty happy. He's like, still got some youth in him. And Alpaca Man is taken out. And of course, it's so sad.
The Alpaca-Cha-Cha slide is over.
All right. Did you see that old man Hyo just toppled a gifter? You think Hyo really is the famous Hyogoro the Flower? And we see his sort of cloak come off and his flower tattoo shows. And he says, if that's what you were hoping to do earlier, maybe I can help you after all. And he's like, yeah, that's it. That's exactly it. Teach me how to do that.
Before we round the chapter off completely, we were talking about Zoro's teacher. That's chapter 194. This is exactly how it goes. Let me see if I can read it. Watch this sheet of paper very closely, Zoro, and he cuts it and nothing happens. It's like, it's still in one piece. Oh, there we go. That's the whole series. It says, listen, there are swordsmen in this world who are able to not cut anything. These same swordsmen also have the ability to cut through steel and with the same instrument. The pinnacle of swordsmanship is the power to protect what one wishes to protect and cut what one wishes to cut. A blade that injures all that it touches isn't really a sword. It's just interesting to see more of Zoro's past kind of come up in the story here, as it's been.
We're coming towards something with Zoro here.
Yeah, I think that's pretty clear. Let's go through the chapter, though. Sam, do you want to start us out with your thoughts?
I thought this chapter was pretty good. I really like how, Luffy's obviously going to, how he upgraded his observation haki in the last arc is now going to be upgrading his armament haki. And I like that it's not just, I'm remembering another lesson Rayleigh taught me that I'm only applying now for some reason. I like that he's got, he needs a teacher. And that endears me to Hyo quite a bit. I was also just thinking, like, yesterday, I was like, you know, we haven't actually seen Luffy use his new observation haki yet. The Hiyori and Zoro stuff, I think that I'm really eager to see what Kawamatsu's deal is. I'm also wondering why, because, you know, the big mystery of, like, what is there, like, a difference between Komurosaki as we knew her and Hiyori as the person we're seeing now? Because it's suspicious to me that, like, her life as an Oiran or her relationship with Kyoshiro has not come up at all in this conversation, which could easily just be like, oh, that's not the perk she wants to talk about right now, or oh, she didn't figure that was important to Zoro. But it seems weird, like, just unfolding the story that way. It makes me wonder what's up there. So
yeah,
those are my general thoughts.
Okay, Jeff.
Yeah, I think this chapter, my thoughts on Wano so far have really not been too positive. And it's kind of weird because Whole Cake Island was the first arc that I caught up to and read week to week. And so my first time I was experiencing, like, oh, everything's so much slower than I remember in past arcs. But I feel like Wano I'm disliking for totally different reasons, where it's like, usually the beginning of an arc is the part that I really love. It's the part where, like, there are all these mysterious elements, mysteries that are going on, trying to figure out what's up with this place, what's really going on. And I feel like that's what I really love about One Piece. And Wano is the first arc where it's like, it's instead of that, it's just like there's so much going on. It's not like any particular mysteries. It's just like there's a million things going on at once. There are like tons of characters. I find it hard to keep track of how many characters. It's like each new chapter is like, here's five new characters. Some of them are named, some of them are unnamed, some of them have names you don't remember. It's hard to
keep track of. Some of them have two names.
Yeah, here's Ashura Mara Doju, Ashuten Doji. Anyway, and so it's like, I found that hard to keep track of, and it just feels like everything is, it's hard to get invested emotionally in things when it's just like, there's so much going on. It's like any emotion that's there is kind of like so quick and is like concentrated, like, you know, it's not really invested in. But this chapter feels like kind of like a turning point. It feels like things are really starting to slow down and be about individuals, and like, you know, we get like the half about Hiyori and the half about Luffy training. I think that generally the stuff that Luffy's been doing with the sumo tournament has been interesting. So I think it's showing like a trend towards the kind of One Piece that I find more appealing, and I'm excited for that. But Hiyori, everything with her is just so strange. Like, it's just so weird and like so tactless to be blabbering so much. And like, I think Sam was saying about like the, her, it's just weird. We don't know what's going on with her, like why she's choosing to talk about this kind of stuff, but not about her other life at all. And it's just like, just confusing at this point. And I also feel like the kind of hype, like the little bits of mystery that they have been playing up, like the, who's the Akaza Nine going to be. I feel like it's not, it reminds me a lot of the hype and mystery leading up to and during Kingdom Hearts 3, where it's like the plot of Kingdom Hearts 3 is going to be seven Guardians of Light and 13 Guardians, I don't know, Seekers of Darkness or something. And it's like, who are the seven going to be? Who are the 13 going to be? And in the end, it's like, it doesn't really matter. Like, it's all kind of, it's just kind of meaningless hype. So I'm like, is it really going to matter who the Akazaya Nine are? Like, is that really going to be important? And so, yeah, I don't know. Lots of thoughts. Luffy learning this stuff is cool, but I also feel like I don't quite understand why it's impactful and significant that this particular attack is so different than his other forms of haki, like where you can just wipe out people with, you know, like the, what he did at the beginning of the tournament, just wiping out a ton of people. It's like, is this, I guess it's a more concentrated kind of push, concentrated punch.
But well, it's for the kind of thing, scales, he says, so.
Yeah, and
with the, like, the Supreme King, you know, Conqueror's haki, like, that works on, that's basically just clearing the board of fodder. It doesn't really work on, like, the big time guys. So this is more of a specific battle-focused thing.
Actually, what happens when that happens is what we saw with Shanks and Whitebeard on the ship. Like, it splits the heavens.
Yeah, and it makes sense that you need specific skills to take down Kaido. That's cool that there's like this big threat very close
but
to him.
But you're not convinced on this specific power.
I feel like the way it was executed in this chapter, I can understand what we're talking about. Like, okay, yeah, this does seem like something that would be particularly useful for his scales. But like for him to be so impressed by Hyo, it's a bit like, I don't know, didn't seem so surprising to me. I was like, oh, that's not that different from what you can already do, but okay. I don't know.
I mean, there must be something more to it. Maybe I'm just giving Oda too much leeway, but I assume there is something more there.
Yeah, especially since they're connecting it to like Zoro's Mr. One fight. But like, is that the connection we're supposed to make, that this particular version of armament haki is what Zoro was using?
Maybe. The way I took it is that they just have a different concept of how to use haki in Wano, and that these are two examples of, so a different use of armament haki. Actually, these are both different uses.
It's like when Edward Elric learns alkahestry instead of alchemy or something like that. It's like different concepts of the same thing.
That's how I interpreted it.
I think it's really cool to have those explicit callbacks to Zoro's original training, or like that mindset, because like I guess it's even more breadcrumbs for there being a connection between his teacher and Wano.
Steven.
Not to just immediately go into a tangent, but you know, just picking up where with what Jeff was talking about, I think what I'm starting to see definitely here, what I've been noticing changing in my opinion is in this arc at the last few chapters, is that it feels like it's not a One Piece mystery arc the way that some of you know the arc setups are, where you're given a bunch of questions and it's like, how does this all fit together? And it's been more of like a, let's just explore the kind of like the local culture of Wano. And I'm positive that that's because, you know, he's specifically basing it on this Edo era Japan. And therefore, you know, like it's not really that there would be mysteries about that culture to the Japanese readers. It's more like, oh, this is so funny that we're seeing all of these kind of old cultural remnants brought into the world of One Piece in these kind of strange and slightly outlandish ways. But I feel like where that is actually going to be paying off is that, you compare this to, let's say, Dressrosa, and, even in this chapter, like I got kind of some Dressrosa flashback vibes from like Hiyori talking about Kawamatsu. It's very similar to Rebecca and the Toy Soldier, albeit without the like sort of ironic and tragic family connection, but just, you know, the concept of the helpless little girl and the protector who helps keep her alive. But the thing, I think one of the problems with Dressrosa is that you had this huge cast of characters, and almost all of them, aside from the Riku royal family, are not like local people. They're just, you know, they're the gladiators, they're the Straw Hats, they're the Doflamingo family. And like, you have all these scenes in the end, towards the climax, where you just have mob scenes of just random people. And they're all like, oh God, you know, thank you, Straw Hat. And, you know, you're going to save us, or we need help, or whatever. And they're just nameless, you know, mob characters. Like they mean nothing to the reader. And I feel like by having drawn so many of these like weird little, you know, just kind of one-off characters like Otoko and Otama and Hitetsu and Otsuru and all of them, he's really fleshing out like the local populace in a way that it's going to feel much more meaningful when we actually get into saving Wano, because there are all these actual fleshed out characters who are, the stakes for them are really important, and we've seen them throughout the arc, and it's, you know, it's going to mean more in that sense. So that's kind of what I'm looking forward to. But as for this chapter itself, like, it's not, I wouldn't say it's the most interesting stuff to me, but I felt like the difference between having the four extra pages as compared to the last, you know, truncated chapter really made a difference, because it felt like the scenes had more time to breathe. And I actually really enjoyed, even though, like, you know, Alpaca Man and Medillo Man are just two more grunts on the way to eventually fighting Queen, who is just another grunt on the way to fighting Kaido, et cetera. Like, it's pretty small stakes stuff, but I really enjoy just the sort of comic combat. It's very, like, the cartoonish nature of it. It's very, like, old Dragon Ball, very early, like, Tenkaichi Budokai type of stuff, which is really fun. And I think it's gonna be fun to reread when the arc is over. So I actually enjoyed it quite a lot.
Big Bomb is coming, too. So that
yeah, that's right.
Oh yeah, that's happening too. Steve.
It's the stuff in the prison's a lot of fun. I kind of like just running the gauntlet of all these weirdos in Kaido's forces. I don't look that deep into the whole stuff going on with what's her face? Not Komono Misaki. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think she's just daft and she's blabbing all this. I don't think there's anything to look into. I don't think there's no split personalities. I don't think there's some deep, dark twist here.
Famous last words.
I've read One Piece long enough where I'm just not going to let crazy expectations like that get the better of me. I don't see it right now. I don't see anything convincing me that there's something more to this. I think Oda will make things a little more obvious. I have no strong opinions one way or the other is basically the gist of what I'm saying. But I feel like I'm starting to pick up on the way Oda writes, and I don't see this being, it's like, oh, I just tricked you into telling you everything I want you to hear or anything like that. I think this is pretty surface level. And if those are my last words, then I will die like a man.
Anything else you want to say about the chapter, Steve?
It was an okay chapter.
Okay, Ed.
I really enjoyed the chapter. It was, I like Zoro's sort of deadpan reaction to, Hiyori's, like, her, just her general nature. Like, is she allowed to hear this, or is she like, just sort of trying to react to her in his way and keep it sort of cool, but she's like talking all over the place. And, yeah, I'm excited to see where this is going. They're putting all their cards in place with, like, Beppo and Law. Like, we haven't seen those characters in weeks at this point, so they're sort of reminding us that they're there. Medillo Man, like, everything in the prison, as you said, was pretty funny. Alpaca Man, like, all the weird noises he makes, and like him getting stunted on. Like, he's terrible. And Luffy schools him, and it shows that Luffy really picked up on what he learned from Whole Cake Island and is pretty much able to use it, which makes sense because these guys aren't good. So it feels like we're killing time, but we're also showing where Luffy's going in the future with what he wants to do with his techniques. And there's still the anyway, we briefly saw the guy in the cage again this chapter, but he just had the one line and we didn't get to see him anymore. So yeah,
probably. Yeah. Oh no, definitely. Well, yeah, it was confirmed when Raizo spoke to him.
Right. See, that I don't remember that stuff. Like, I need to reread these chapters.
Yeah, I mean, Wano would definitely benefit from some rereads, just because of the amount of characters, mm-hmm. as Jeff was saying. Ed, anything else you want to mention?
Yeah, Hyo looks really cool at the end of this. Like, he turns his face black and he shows off his tattoo. Like, he's a real Yakuza man. That's some good stuff. He looks cool.
He does.
Music.
Yeah, I really enjoyed this chapter. And maybe it's something like what Steven was saying. When you put, like, an ugly person next to someone who's not as ugly, it makes the other person. So like last chapter was kind of disappointing because it was short and, you know, not very good. But this chapter I really enjoyed. We got to sit really in just two scenes separated by that middle two-page spread in the jail. We had just Zoro and what he's doing in, what is this called? Rango? Ringo? Is that what it's called? Yeah, Ringo, because it's the Beatles thing. In Snowy Ringo. And then we got Luffy in Udon. And those two scenes we get to sit in, and we get to sit with these characters and enjoy these particular moments. On the smaller scale stuff, I mean, it's kind of what Jeff was talking about. The reason I enjoy this arc is because I am a nerd about a lot of these Japanese historical and cinematic kind of things that Oda is doing. Even if I'm not completely familiar with them, I enjoy those flourishes. Like even the setting of Ringo with the thatched roofs looks like the Shirakawa-go and Gokayama, I think it's called, in Western Honshu, I think, Japan. So that's really cool to see just like the kind of care Oda puts in to reference and all that kind of stuff, or pay homage to. The Akazaya 9 thing, I don't know. It's kind of like, for me, I do agree that it's not really important who they are, but I kind of get that feeling like as a kid, ooh, I have to collect them all and see what they're all like. I would definitely
collect... There's also that suspicious detail of, you know, like 9 makes you think of the Straw Hats, right?
Yeah, yeah. Maybe the Akazaya 9 maybe with the Straw Hats the whole time.
Well, like maybe...
Yeah. Maybe that's why they can't have Jinbei yet.
Yeah. Like at the last second, the samurai can't fill the role, and it's the Straw Hats who are playing the samurai now. Or
I think Oda's definitely setting something up there that we don't know what it is, but I think I have enough faith in Oda there to give us a good payoff. I think that's one of the things he's usually good at. I'm very curious as to why this is the first moment we find out that Dogstorm and Cat Viper were two of them. That seems like such a weird thing to kind of throw in there. Maybe it was mentioned before and we just missed it. But I hadn't noticed that. And then with every time I see Luffy, I really enjoy the chapter, I feel like. We talked about just the fun comedic fights with these really ridiculous characters. I enjoy every smile fruit user we have seen in this story. They are so absurd. I don't know if that's just because us on the podcast, we enjoy the most absurd aspects of One Piece. I don't know if that's like a common thing in the community, but I could only speak for myself. And I really enjoyed Medillo Man. Medillo Man. He has an A, so... A Medillo Man. And Alpaca Man I've enjoyed since we were first introduced with him. Actually, the most disappointing thing about this chapter is Alpaca Man being taken out of commission at the end. Hiyo, super cool ending. I liked Hiyo before, now I really like him. And Queen cackling in the background, I feel like, is a worthy mention. Here at the end of the manga recap, I'm enjoying Queen as a character, even though he is just in the background being an asshole. That's all I have to say about the chapter. Do you guys have any lingering thoughts? Or if not, might as well move into the next segment.
All right.
This is the anime recap for episode 880. Sabo goes into action. All the captains of the Revolutionary Army appear. I'm your host Sam, and today with me we have Ed.
Hey. And as I pointed out in the intro, Sabo doesn't do much of anything at all in this episode.
Yeah.
Sabo in action.
Yeah. The telecard begins at 3 minutes and 35 seconds. Still not a lot of recap up front.
Although I should say, in the song, as I have it on in the background on mute, there are Revolutionary Army captains in the opening now.
Yeah, I forgot if I brought this up. Like they changed the opening a couple weeks ago.
Mm-hmm.
There's a section of the opening now that is dedicated to footage from like the given episode. So there's you'll see clips of whatever episode you're about to watch, and then there's also the kind of reverie still shots and stuff.
Right.
Not a lot of recap lately.
No. Although I do find it interesting that the whole new recap thing starts with an eclipse. You know.
Yeah.
The moon, always moon imagery.
Yeah, gotta keep an eye on that stuff.
Mm-hmm. Keep watching the skis.
So we open the episode in a port town in the kingdom of Lelusia, which is, I think, where Princess Kimone from last week was from.
The whiny one, right? Or the violent one.
Yeah, the woman kicking her kidnappers.
Right.
There's a mysterious, threatening-looking pirate with a pink mustache. Leading a fight against some Marines, and the townspeople who are kind of cowering.
Realize how stupid that would look in full color.
Well, it's the brown hair plus the pink mustache and beard.
Yeah, he's even lamer than Brownbeard. Brownbeard is ended up being a good guy.
I mean, there's always a chance for Peachbeard. So
I don't know about that after this, man.
Prevalent in this episode is Moda. From Ace's cover story, the milk girl.
She is carrying the milk for the children, which is weird because it's not refrigerated or anything, but, you know, you do what you gotta do.
So the pirates are attacking because the king has gone to the reverie. So this is an example of this big political meeting making certain places of the world more vulnerable. The pirate is talking about how he is an affiliate of Blackbeard's and he has been bestowed the name Peachbeard. So I guess you got to earn the right to be a beard. And he has a bounty of 52 million berries. Peachbeard notices Mona running away. They're like, "What's that milk, little girl? Oh, even if it's not worth much, we still want it." For some reason.
Yeah.
And they knock her to the ground and her tooth falls out.
I wasn't sure if it was always like that, and I didn't bother to go look at the cover story whether she was always missing a cute tooth like that, but
I don't know. Like they like knock it out in this episode.
Okay.
And I'm sure it'll grow back when she drinks some of that milk.
Of course.
So they have some talk about the heavenly tribute to the celestial dragons. The pirates figure that they've got to have some sort of stash of money in the town somewhere so they can pay the government. And there's almost a brief moment where you think that the pirates are like sympathetic to the townspeople because the government is taking so much money from them, but then they're like, "Oh, well, that's just more money for us. Let's go find those tribute funds." Because Peachbeard even has to he has to comment that their king sounds terrible. "Oh man, your living circumstances are so terrible. I'm sorry that I'm just about to make it much, much worse."
Then some people wander in from the alley.
Yeah, yeah.
And mysterious Moda
in red. Moda gets
the purple
knocked,
hair.
Yeah, Moda gets knocked around a lot in this episode, but she falls into something soft.
Yeah,
this time
it's squishy. Very
Something breaks her fall.
Very inspiring. Inspires me. I mean,
which is the mysterious woman's boobs, because she's not wearing a lot.
I like her gag of running everyone down in order to build them up.
She's negging them, basically.
I guess.
So the woman, we don't get to see her full face yet, but she's. The woman is saying, "Go, Morley." And that is when Morley is born from the ground.
Yep.
A giant man pushing his way
trident.
With a big trident pushing his way through the ground because he's got a devil fruit that allows him to just scoop the world up and just push things around. He has All Might's voice in Japanese.
Really? And he's doing a teen girl, like, he's using teen girl sayings. Like, and it comes across even more so when it, like in the anime, because like, you know, there are phrases and things that you recognize from watching a lot of anime over the years. Like, these are things a teenage girl would say, and it's a large man. And the incongruity is amusing, especially more so in the anime even.
Yeah, and the pirates are bemused by Morley's miniskirt. We get this nice shot of Morley's miniskirt from behind. And like Morley's like making a half attempt to cover himself up. And he's like, oh, what are you guys looking at? You attracted to me or something? And Peachbeard is Frost. No, he's like, why am I being accused of this?
Don't be so mean.
So Morley pushes the ground around. The woman, the mysterious woman, is showing up in front of the townspeople, and she's saying, you passive pieces of trash. She's got a nice husky smoker's voice. Did we ever figure out if Lindbergh was like a cat or a mouse or what? What is he?
I thought he was a rabbit.
I don't think he's a rabbit. He's a mink, but I don't think he's a rabbit.
Yeah, I don't know.
I think he's a cat.
We'll see.
He shows up. He's got a little jetpack. This is the revolutionaries. They're all just a bunch of like steampunk kids. He's mad at Morley for causing so much trouble already because he had a new weapon that he wanted to use and now he might not get the chance. And then the fourth character shows up, a crow man on the roof. Crows are wandering or coming to him and like forming his cape. Was that clear in the manga that his cape was made of crows?
It's his body, I think. His body.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, and he's got the deep voice and he's all muffled.
Yeah, so this is an interesting. This is an example of like adaptation, because in the manga they don't. It's just an ellipses. Like you can't hear what he's saying at all.
Oh, that's true. Yeah,
and here they have to give him like dialogue and like figure out how to present his muffled voice. Although, it reminds me of there's a character in Black Clover named Gordon. And his kind of shtick, he looks like a mime, and his shtick is that he talks very softly. And so he'll have these really long, sometimes like big, rousing speeches, like, you can do it, Asta. But he's so quiet that nobody can hear him. And he's just like, talking to him. Asta, you can do it. The best of us. And like the show has to like put like subtitles up so the audience can hear him. That's what this guy reminds me of. Although they didn't, I feel like they could have made the muffledness of his voice more obvious.
Yeah, it's just sort of quiet.
Yeah, because you get to a part of the episode where Peachbeard's like, what? I can't understand you. What are you saying? But like, it's not that hard to hear what he's saying for the audience. So
you get a scene on the Sunny where Nami basically just describes the Revolutionary Army.
Yeah, yeah. Well, or Luffy. So Nami and Kara, they're just kind of sitting on the bench and they're reading the paper together. And Luffy, in a uncharacteristic moment of curiosity, he's asking Nami if there's anything about the Revolutionary Army in the newspaper. And the narrator kind of goes down the basics. You know, they're fighting the Celestial Dragons. It's led by Luffy's father, and one of his brothers is the chief of staff.
Mm-hmm. Then we get a flashback to Dressrosa and like well animated, and then we cook back to the ship and I was like, no article about the revolutionaries.
Yeah, exactly. That's why I thought it was funny. But she does remind us that we learned before Whole Cake Island that their headquarters were destroyed by the Blackbeard pirates.
But so they get their new digs.
Yeah. So we cut to another scene. We're reaching Kamabaka Kingdom, Queendom. It's kind of the replacement headquarters for the Revolutionary Army. We see Dragon and Koala kind of arriving to their meeting spot in this like cherry blossom forest. And they're like in these big coats and stuff. And they arrive and Sabo, he's off to the side. He's reading the newspaper and he's smiling. And that's the eye catch of the episode.
Yeah, and I love having Ivankov back.
yeah, Ivankov is great. He's very impressed by Luffy's accomplishments, and you know, he's surprised. He, they, wherever we're referring to Ivankov as.
I believe Ivankov is a man today.
Yeah. He notes that he finds it interesting to learn that Sanji is a prince of Jiruma 66. And then Dragon has zero opinions to offer about Luffy right now. And he's
Sabo, on the other hand, is hurting his face.
Yeah.
He's smiling so much.
Dragon's explaining that Jiruma has been expelled by the world government, so they can't show up on the rivery. Inazuma and Hack are there, Jinbei's best friend Hack.
Yep. They're just sort of sitting around.
Yep. Yeah, that's where Sabo has the cramps on his face. He answers the phone, where like the shot is like above, like he's still like laying on the ground and the shot's like above him, and he looks really, really cool. He looks really nice, just like with his hair kind of tousled up and like falling down to the ground.
We do see that Morley and Betty are the two most popular of the with the residents of Kamabaka Queendom.
Yes, and they're talking about how they're gearing up to properly declare war on the Celestial Dragons. So we come back to the scene with the revolutionary captains. Bello Betty is the woman. She's trying to pump the townspeople up. She's talking crap on them, but she's also like, oh, don't you want to fight back? Aren't you tired of being nice? Don't you want to go crazy? And she's like waving her flag around. The gusts of wind are kind of arousing the crowd. Mm-hmm. It's the pump fruit, which is not a nice sounding name for a fruit.
Because it pumps?
Yeah, it pumps. And it's like a, yeah. So the action is going. The townspeople are fighting back. They've all picked up like suspiciously similar looking sticks, club shaped sticks.
Like the one dude who gets suddenly buff.
Yeah,
big bulging muscles.
Yeah, Moda's ready to fight the little girl. The revolutionaries are fighting alongside them. Lindbergh has he's shooting his ice gun.
Let's kick some ice.
The crows are flying around and stealing all the pirate swords, and Moda gets in the final blow with Peachbeard, with a final gust of wind from Betty.
You know what killed the Peachbeard? The Ice Age. Anyway,
scene fades to black. We come back in. It's a little bit later, and all the pirates are sailing off except for Peachbeard, who's got tied up, and they like Morley pushes him into the ground,
smushes him.
Yeah,
and he's literally stuck in the stone. Like, yeah, that's worth 52 million.
Yeah, Peach. His wanted poster spells out Momohige in Roman letters. And they tell the townspeople that they can have the bounty on his head because 52 million is not a lot for the revolutionaries. It's nothing. And it should be good for helping this town get back on its feet.
Mm-hmm.
Betty, gives Moda their contact information. She says, you did great. She smiles. She pulls her glasses down. She's being cool. And then they all, you know, are walking away together, and Lindbergh is like, oh, Karasu, you forgot to turn on your loudspeaker. And that's when Karasu realizes, oh, that's why people couldn't hear me. And he turns it on, and now he can talk normal, and he's got kind of a voice effect as he talks through the plague doctor's mask.
Mm-hmm.
Back on Kamabaka, and Koala gets a call and learns that everyone's ready to go. And Sabo, the last shot is Sabo smiling. All right, let's go drag down the Celestial Dragons. Boom, to be continued.
I like that bit where Bella Betty pulls down her sunglasses.
Yeah.
It's cool.
Yeah. General thoughts on the episode, Ed?
I could feel it moving slowly, but at this point, like it sort of makes sense to extend the introduction of the Revolutionary Army, because mm-hmm. they're going to be really important. And I think just sort of giving them their own entire, like their whole episode, except for a little bit with Luffy. And that's really just to set up like an info dump, or at least a refresher, because it's not new information. But yeah, I enjoyed it. I love all these characters, and Sabo sort of just being in this world is great, and interacting with people. And Dragon's kind of a wet blanket.
Yeah.
He doesn't do much. Like all the interesting stuff is either for Koala or Sabo to do.
Yeah. This episode looks great. It looks like it's like TV special quality, I want to say.
I don't know about that, because there wasn't the level of action animation, because right. There wasn't that much action. But I can see what you mean.
The drawings look really good. They touch. There's a lot of touching up going on. So I thought that was good. I enjoyed their introduction. I enjoyed their banter like a lot more than in the manga. In the manga, mm-hmm. it's like, oh, here's a bunch of new crazy character designs. But like in the anime, it's more, it's the camaraderie is a little more rich, I think. And they're sort of the way they bounce off of each other and the way they bounce off of the townspeople. So mm-hmm. I thought that was really good. And it's just like cool kind of jumping back and forth between this port town, which is all like dreary and like the dark clouds. And then you got the Kamabaka, which is just like bright and colorful and beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I don't know. That was a pretty good episode. We're still kind of dipping our toes into the Reverie stuff, but
Reverie stuff's going to be crazy.
Yeah. So yeah, I thought it was pretty good. Ready to move on to the next segment?
I'm ready.
All right, let's go.
All right, cool.
This is the Piece Together segment where we take your questions, comments, and theories and then dance to them. Yeah. Okay, I danced. That doesn't work on a podcast, I understand, but just note, I danced and it was bad.
There's video of you dancing. They don't need to see it though.
Is there? Oh, there is. Oh yeah, that's. Oh, God.
I'm sure Amazon has it.
okay. Sam, let's start with. Actually, Ed, you could do the theme for it.
Oh, this piece.
Yeah, Sam, what do we have on Discord this week?
Our first this piece comes from our good friend Joe. In One Piece World Seeker, there is a karma system where Luffy can win over the approval of characters such as the Straw Hats, Law, Sabo, and even characters like Lucci, Crocodile, and Sakazuki by doing certain tasks and missions for them. For example, performing certain attacks on different characters or beating up certain numbers of enemies. What are things you would have Luffy do to earn your praise and raise your karma level?
Oh, man. Hot dog contest?
I mean what I would have to do for Luffy for him to give me some karma, is that the
question? No, what if you were a character in the game, what would Luffy have to do so that he's on your good side?
Luffy be like, well, hey Steve, so I watched NXT TakeOver last weekend, and I'll be like, oh, tell me about it.
Talk about wrestling with Steve. Yeah. Yes.
First, I have to be like 8 years old and helpless, and then I'd point him to the direction of the bullies who are beating me up, and then he'll beat him up, and then I'm a kid in a filler movie.
Oh God, you're one of those, Steven.
All right.
Yeah, Sam. What else?
And she has a postscript. P.S. If you're wondering what Sakazuki says when Luffy has maxed out his karma, he tells Luffy he's going to reunite him with Ace. Isn't he the nicest guy? Yeah.
Wow, that's dark.
I think I saw that scene. It's like, oh, maybe you're not so bad. Maybe I'll kill you later or something. Well, it's good to know he has his priorities straight. Yeah. Our next this piece comes from Morgil. I was a little disappointed that last week's episode didn't have the embedded images for the volume recap. I checked several different players and even the YouTube version.
Yeah, I was testing that out. I wanted to see if people noticed or cared, because it is a ton of work and I don't usually get a lot of feedback from it.
You want to tell the people where you edited this episode?
Where I what?
Where you edited the episode? Weren't you on the
train? Oh, I edited on the train. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's the thing I'm trying to do sometimes now. I'm editing the episodes on the train. Yeah, I mean, I also stupidly did not, for some reason, did not have the volume on me. So that also made it more difficult because then I would have to ask one of my fellow podcasters to take those pictures. And so look, if that's something you guys out there do really want and do really care about, please let me know and I will try and include them next time. But if that's something you don't really care about, then I'm not going to do that. So yeah, a combination of laziness and inability, the answer to that.
Yeah. Anyway, please. We had a huge time crunch last
year. Yeah, that one was.
Everything kind of went wrong. Yeah, so.
Yeah, oh, God. It was
tough. Also, it's not like Zach's getting paid.
Well, I mean, Patreon, I guess, kind of.
But yeah.
Kind of. It's mostly Patreon money goes to the podcast, not
giving you an out, Zach.
That's true.
Yeah, you were giving me an out. I should have taken it. Go ahead, Sam.
Yeah, our next disc piece comes from Straw Hat Pirate 9. I'm proud to report that I've convinced another coworker of mine, Jacob, to give One Piece a try, and the brave soul wanted to watch it. He's been at it for 2 weeks, and he's 2 weeks and a half, and he's currently on episode 68. It has been a blast reliving the series with him, and he knows nothing about it, so everything is fresh and a surprise. It's super hard to hold my tongue at all the "this moment will pay off like this" parts. I've told him about this podcast, and he's a little sad that we won't be able to listen to you guys for a while. That he won't be able to listen to you guys for a while, he won't be able to listen to you guys for a year and a half with how behind he is.
You should listen to the read through. That's what he should do.
Yeah, it's a good in between, and we're the prize at the end of the road. Yeah, when you get through everything, you're like, you know, I just watched through 900 something or read through 900 something chapters, watched through 800
something episodes. And all I got was this crappy podcast.
No. And now I have another 560 something episodes of this podcast to listen to. So yeah,
I mean, realistically, we started the podcast during Impel Down.
Impel Down. Yeah, you could go back once you get up to Impel Down. You could totally just listen to us if you're brave.
I mean, I wouldn't, but
more subjective thing.
They all sound like Walter Matthau, Homer Simpsons back then.
Well, let's all
record this podcast. Let's all go out for frosty chocolate milkshakes.
You stole my joke.
It was my joke. You were just trying to jump on it.
To be fair, yes. Sam, any other piece?
Yes.
Yeah.
Our final disc piece comes from Grim Pyro. Well, no wonder it's taking Jinbei forever to get to Wano. He keeps making pit stops. Maybe the next cover story will be Jinbei eating gas station hot dog or Jinbei picking up a new kimono at JCPenney.
damn it. I wish we didn't choose the episode title because Jinbei picking up kimono at JCPenney is an amazing title.
Yeah. Jinbei visiting relatives in Annapolis, Maryland.
Yeah, that's
just like that.
Right under Grim Pyro's comment, Morgill says Jinbei visits relatives in Annapolis, Maryland. Oh, okay. Okay, and Jinbei poses for trading card photo.
Love it.
I knew I shouldn't have gotten that haircut.
I would collect an entire like card set of just all of the inane things Jinbei's doing. Well,
isn't that just what the Orlumbus cover story was?
Oh, it is. Except the thing is, Orlumbus you don't care about. Jinbei you want to get there, so it like makes it extra funny. So that's the last disc piece.
Yes.
Okay, so let's move on to emails. The first one, and this is from Ben Wild. I can't believe, I don't know the last time he's done this. I feel like it was recent. It's that time of year again. The world's largest trivia contest is going on. So to keep with my tradition, here are my trivia questions for you. And for those who don't know, it's $20 for every correct answer to the podcast.
Man, I thought this happened already, but...
Yeah, geez. I thought we did this year, but I'm not going to correct him if we did. I can't believe that. Can't believe we've been doing this for as long as we have. So here we go. A new year, new Ben Wild. Five questions. Okay, ready, guys?
All right.
What is the name of Chimney's rabbit?
Oh, Gonbei.
Gonbei.
Blurring it out.
Yeah.
Yeah. We could say it. It's not by the trivia rules that we use at the end of this. If you know
it's a team effort.
It's a team effort. We all have to work together here. What is the name of the deadly gas that was used on Zo?
Oh, there's a name.
Oh yeah, it's not the smiley. Smiley.
No, it's not Shinokuni. No. Yeah.
Oh, is it
be like a GX13 or something?
Oh
like
yeah.
Yeah, it's probably something.
Do we want to go back to that one while we try and ponder that a little more?
Sure.
These get harder. How many members are there in the Big Mom family?
Oh god.
Was it like 143 or something?
Well, of the family, it's like 82 or something like that.
Oh yeah, does that also include the husbands?
No, I think that named characters wouldn't include like, the. Yeah, like named the, in the magazine, I think.
Is that 82? Are we going with 82? Is that our That's final my guess. Answer? Okay.
Yeah, it sounds like 40 sons. Like, if 40 sons and daughters sounds about right.
Yeah, I thought it was 140, including the husbands or something like that. 142 or something.
Right, but do characters like Baron Tamago count?
No, that's not the family.
That's not the family. Okay. That's the crew. Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, it counts in my heart, but that's not what matters. Next one. What number zombie is Hilden?
Oh my god.
I wish I was paying more attention to Grant's image. The thing is, I am, and I don't remember.
834.
Was it a high number or was it a low number?
Like, I guess it was a low number.
Yeah, I think it was a low one.
I don't feel like he's in like the 20s somewhere.
I thought he was
it's like 36 or something.
I thought 23 is the number that pops into my head. So do we have an answer we're going to collectively come to here?
These are all really freaking hard this year.
Yeah, these are so random.
Most of these are numbers. Including this last one. What is the code to the Sunny's refrigerator? This one, I remember this SBS.
Well, it's
Nami and Robin's names.
Oh yeah, that's what it is.
Was it their names or was it their birthdays? I think it's their names. What are the numbers?
Then it might be
like 73, 62 or something like that. That would be Nami Robi. I don't know.
It's
probably longer than that, but I think that's the general gist of it.
All right. And the last question, which is most important, is what did you think of the Star Wars trailer? We don't get money for that one, I don't think.
I'm excited.
Got me excited. I'm on board. It just means that, you know, Alex and I could just keep doing Palpatine impressions for.
Yeah, I mean, at the very least.
At the time. Who do you think I immediately texted when that trailer dropped?
He's at Celebration, so like him and Dennis, I think, are both at Celebration. Mm-hmm. So.
Oh, Dennis is there too.
Did we ever come up with a name for that that poison gas?
GX-37. No. Are we thinking of the bazooka he used too? Because wasn't that with GX-40 something gas?
Well, those are the KX launchers.
Yeah, Rise of Skywalker is a stupid name. If you haven't followed me on Twitter, but yeah, the trailer was good. That I could answer. Next one is from this is an interesting question. This is from Ryan, who says, if you could have John Oliver do a Last Week Tonight segment about something in the One Piece world, what would it be? For example, the Navy, the world government, devil fruits, etc. Ryan says I could see him making a joke about how there are only three admirals and so many vice admirals, like there are too many vice admirals and that Strawberry's head is way too tall or something like that.
How much do you think it would cost to hire John Oliver to do an episode that just describes the plot of One Piece completely straight?
I pay for that.
John Oliver just takes down slavery.
We were talking about our Patreon. Maybe we should be raising money to do that. I think that is a worthy cause.
The serious answer of what John Oliver do, he would be like the Fujitora. He would take down, he would go into how corrupt it is that the government is working with pirates
and sanctioning their pirating activities, etc.
And he do so using just like the most ridiculous, hypocritical, like,
well, slavery. I mean, there's slavery.
Yeah,
too.
Yeah. I mean,
it's like that's ripe for parody. I mean, it'd be ridiculous because he'd be making a joke of slavery, but like, you know, that's Sean Oliver. He'll joke about anything.
Guys, it's the year whatever it is, and there's still slavery. I mean, no, come on.
He'll have like the little interjection where he's like, "It's fucked up, Sengoku. I don't care that you have a cute goat. It's fucked up."
hashtag fucked up, hashtag fucked up cute goat.
Did we ever come up with a name for that poison gas?
Next question comes from Martin. Has there ever been a color scheme reveal that has really bothered or surprised you once you saw it on a volume cover or in the anime? For example, Betty's purple hair kind of blindsided me. I didn't see that, actually, so I should probably watch the episode.
It looked like when fan color... I mean, this is kind of how a lot of One Piece color schemes come across, but they look like when fans do their own, like, coloring of the manga, and it just, like, it's a little too clean-looking.
Mm-hmm. I know what you mean, yeah.
And very colorful.
I think a lot of people were kind of thrown off by the Komurasaki hair color.
And Otoko.
And Otoko, I mean, that kind of thing is not super important to me. I think the original Kuma coloring took me more by surprise.
You stole my first answer.
Sorry.
Well, I mean, it's nothing really to get angry about. But
do you have other answers? Well,
yeah, creamsicle Kuma.
Yeah.
Creamsicle Kuma.
I like it.
Orange is not an intimidating color. Man, what were some other ones that were really jarring? Remember when we like lost our shit over like purple Marco? His purple shirt.
I don't remember that.
That was more of an anime thing, but
I remember his high heels and that being a big thing that we talked about. It was an interesting design choice. Anyway, I think is that all we have for emails today?
There's gotta be more wacky colors here. You just named two recent characters. Come on, there's got to be more. And what?
Oh, I think Whitebeard's. Okay. How about Whitebeard's flowing blonde locks?
Oh. Yeah, I guess that wasn't such a surprise. Yeah, I'm like trying to think. I don't get taken that by surprise by most color choices, I don't think. Like, let Oda do what he wants. It's his series. I don't really care. The thing is, you just assume everything's black and white when you're reading it, but obviously it is not.
The Vinsmokes, I think most people just assume they were going to be blonde like Sanji.
Oh, yeah.
I like what he did, though, that they each have, like, a color scheme and it goes into the hair, and that it might be related to the genetic engineering. I think I like that, personally.
Katakuri having, like, kind of plum hair.
I like that too.
Yeah.
Because he's not the most exciting personality, so give him some plum hair. Yeah.
Dude, he likes donuts and taking naps.
To be
he
fair,
he doesn't have a personality because people shame him for it.
That's mm-hmm. true. That's true. No, I'm not saying he doesn't have like a good character. I'm just he's not the most exciting character. So give him a little bit of purple hair. You got to have purple hair. Ed, it's time too.
Peace the tweet.
Yeah, Reddit was barren this week, so we're gonna go straight to Twitter.
Well, actually, we did have one or two. Yes, one or two did come in at the last second.
Go for it.
They didn't set up the thing. Oh, I don't know. Can you unring that bell? Ed already pieced the tweet.
It's my podcast. I could unring whatever the hell I want.
Okay. All right. It's been rewound. Okay, so Baker Turtle 17 says, I wanted to ask about the situation with Law and his crew being captured. Earlier, we saw how Shinobu was skeptical of Law's crew being the ones to reveal the plans, but now that we see they are staying loyal, How do you think this plot point goes moving forward? I find this the most interesting part of the story right now because it could cause a rift in the Alliance as Law's crew is now in danger and he's complained about the Straw Hats throughout the arc. My question is, do you think it's possible that Law could betray the Alliance in the future?
No.
No.
I feel like that's something... I feel like Law's forever loyalty is something we earned in Dressrosa at the very least.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I feel like you would need more focus and time for, like, he's too well liked of a character now for him to just go full irredeemable, right? So, like, if he were to betray, it would have to be some kind of longer arc of being redeemed in the end. And do they have time for that?
And, like, just because they have an argument over, like, how to do things or that, you know, Shinobu is like, you know, this isn't a game. That sort of thing. That doesn't mean that Law is going to turn around and be like, oh yeah, well, I'm going to join Kaido then. You know, that's not that's not his character. Or, you know, that's not how he would choose to make his displeasure known, I guess I would say. So, unfortunately, we don't have Alex here, so we'll have to make do with what we've got. Because Niver says, who would you rather hear narrate One Piece, Ringo Starr or George Carlin? Of course, referring to Thomas the Tank Engine.
If it's child friendly, Ringo Starr. If it's an angry narrator, George Carlin.
So George Carlin is the Scanlator narrator.
There's a whole lot of F-bombs.
Gilbert Gottfried.
Oh God.
Okay.
you could try to channel the spirit of Alex all you want, Ed, but he's not going to show up. I'm talking about Alex.
But no, just Gilbert Gottfried's real voice, the really calm serial killer voice.
Oh, is that what they call it?
Yeah, when he's not shrieking, that's a put on. Anyway,
I guess Twitter. Any more Ed.
Any more Reddit questions, Steve?
Nope, that's it.
Okay. First one for a piece this week comes from a nervous flower who says, I hope Steven is on this episode because I have to know, was the arresting pun on page 9 present in Japanese or was that yours?
Oh, that was a little fun. Wasn't that fun? Didn't we enjoy that?
wait, where are we looking here?
On the Rosetsu Prisoners Quarters page where they say it's quite an arresting sight and there are still more to come.
Oh, God.
It's very good.
I wasn't going to point it out if you guys weren't, so somebody noticed it.
I didn't
know. She also loves the bonsai head guy.
Yeah, that was great. I like that nobody noticed it until Jeff pointed it out.
So that's your pun, Steven. It's quite an interesting sight.
I think it probably was. I can't remember if there was something like that in there in the original text.
To be fair, Steven is like, what do you call it? Channeling Oda's actual like intentions, I think, because I think if Oda could put a pun somewhere, he probably would.
That's generally how I view things, is that it's kind of like it's like a give and take, like you win some, you lose some, where like sometimes there's a joke that he writes that doesn't really work in English, and sometimes I see a spot where I'm like, oh, if Oda was writing this in English, he would totally make this joke, and so it kind of evens out in the long run.
Quite an arresting sight. What's next, Ed?
Next one comes from Nine Claw Tiger, who says, this question is for Jeff. As the foremost expert on manga apps, which do you recommend? I bought a humble bundle of digital manga and would like to read them on my commute. Android phone, PDF, EPUB, CBZ formats.
Oh, yeah. So I'm not personally too familiar with Android apps. The landscape of other apps aside from the Viz and Shonen Jump ones, but I looked into this a little bit. And so the question is for people who have bought the Humble Bundle and then have a bunch of DRM-free manga and want an app to read it. And it seems like Bubble is a nice-looking app that is pretty simple, straightforward for that. And there's a couple, if you Google, can find some Reddit threads of people suggesting other ones. But it seems like there are a couple of different ones to choose from. But if I were to play around with one of them, I would have gone with Bubble. That looks pretty nice and clean.
Right on.
Yeah.
And next question comes from Nick Fridge, who says, could Zoro's old master Koshiro be one of the Akazaya Nine?
Well, let's see, what was the thing from the exact wording from the SBS that we covered last week? It was like the descendants, right, of the ship that came to East Blue?
No, the descendant of the person who came would be a person that you would know.
Right.
But that doesn't assume that the person reading is a huge nerd, though, who would know who Zoro's master's name is.
No, but he's clearly talking about, you know, that's the most likely character. So that's what I'm saying, is that if it's a descendant, then it's very unlikely that, because I think we're talking about a ship that probably came further than 20 years ago.
I thought it was the saying was that the descendant of the person who came on the ship is a character you all know. But I guess they don't figure most people would know that Queena's father's name. So.
Yeah, well, that's not really an issue. The issue is that Koshiro wouldn't be the Akazaya figure because the ship that we're talking about came over like 100 years ago or something like that. Okay. Like he's the descendant of whoever was on that ship from Wano originally. Mm. Yeah.
Okay. Last one comes from our very own Brian Newton. Dark King Zoro on Twitter says, I miss sharing on all the good Zoro moments recently. Glad to get confirmation that the ability to hear the breath of all things is just an advanced haki technique, and double down on Zoro's sensei being more than he seems.
Isn't it the voice of all things, not the breath of all things?
No, the voice of all things was Roger. The breath of all things is Zoro and Cutting
Stuff. Yeah, yeah.
Okay. I'm glad I've cleared that up for myself.
Not terribly different from each other.
No.
I mean, I think Oda is like sort of steadily folding everything into some unified concept of haki and all of its related powers. So that's.
I look forward to purchasing his book or getting his pamphlet on that. The unified theory on.
Yep.
Haki.
Well, yeah, that was it.
Yeah. All right. Cool. So, you guys ready to round off?
Let's do it.
Oh, sorry. There was one more thing that wasn't in the piece to tweet hashtag. But David Bednar posted the thing about Koshiro and posted the two panels side by side.
So I saw that right after we mentioned that on on the actual show. I'm like, oh, someone already saw this.
Anyway, we can move on now.
Okay, then we will.
This is something new, the Casper Slide Part 2, featuring the Platinum Band, and this time, we're gonna get funky. Funky. Everybody clap your hands. Clap, 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 clap your hands. Clap, 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 clap your hands. All right, now, we're gonna do the basic step. To the left. Take it back now, y'all. One hop this time. Right foot, let's start.
This has been the One Piece Podcast, episode 565 for April 14th, 2019. Great episode today, you guys. If you have not, this is a pretty good time to subscribe to us on Patreon at patreon.com/onepiecepodcast. We post alternate episode images and titles. We post exclusives, outtakes, extended versions of episodes sometimes. We post videos. All of the One Piece Podcast Goes to Japan movie is on there. If you were $1 and up, and if you want to see deleted scenes and commentary, that is all available if you were $10 and up. And if you were $5 and up, I posted, I think this was last week now, my top 10 One Piece Podcast episodes of the last 10 years. Believe it or not, some of it finagle a little. I put a few more episodes in there, but definitely worth a read, I think, if you want to see like what I remember over the last decade. I am positive I have forgotten some pretty amazing episodes in there, and probably more fondly remember some that, you know, may not even be as good as I remember necessarily. But if you also want to hear some of the backgrounds of those episodes and some of the behind-the-scenes stories, that's a really good place to go. So again, that's all at patreon.com/onepiecepodcast. I want to thank everyone here today for coming on. Steven, where could people find you?
You can follow me on Twitter at Translatosaurus.
Sam, where could people find you?
They can find me on Twitter at Lucky Chainsaw. They can find me on AnimeNewsNetwork.com doing the daily streaming reviews for One Piece, Black Clover, and JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, Golden Wind.
Not Bleach.
And they can find me on the One Piece podcast every week doing the doing the anime recaps.
Doing the daily anime recap.
Yeah. Every day.
I'm exhausted. If you want a daily anime recap, just follow Jill's Twitter.
And Jeff, sure. Where can people find you?
You can find me on Twitter at Definitely Jeff. Also, check out the Viz and Shonen Jump apps on iOS and Android if you don't already. If you're outside of, I don't want to list all 10 territories because it's not just US, but US, Canada, UK, Ireland, blah, blah, blah. There's 10 total.
India,
Philippines, Singapore,
South Africa.
I think maybe we named all 10. Anyway, you can get the Viz and Shonen Jump apps there. Canada, is that a country? I don't know.
And there go all of our Canadian listeners. Go ahead.
Check those out. And if you have any feedback about the apps, which I'm sure people have, I think the best way to send that in is in the apps themselves, in the settings tab, there will be a feedback link and you can write your messages there. Really, even above telling me directly, like sending feedback that way is the best way for it to get to the rest of the team and to make sure we all hear it. And we're always listening to everyone's feedback and suggestions. And so that really helps, to hear from users and readers and how we always want to improve things. So yeah.
Yeah. Please do. And it's been, and as I said before, I think it's been improving like significantly. It's really cool to see. Also with just, we haven't talked to you since, everything went down. Since it's been legal and free and simultaneous and global, how was that whole process? I should have asked you this at the beginning.
Oh, well, it's been crazy. There's been so much going on. It's crazy from my perspective, just like how much more interest there is in the apps. Like I've always had in like TweetDeck a filter showing people talking about Shonen Jump apps. And it's been like, it used to be like, oh, there'd be a tweet once a week or something where someone mentioned the word app and Shonen Jump accidentally. And but since that announcement and launch, like it's just been crazy. There's so much discussion, just seeing people talking about it in like places I'd never thought of. Like there was like an AV Club review of Chainsaw Man recently. And I was like, oh, okay. Never would have thought of that being a thing that people would be talking about in like more prominent places. And it's just been crazy seeing people, so much easier to get into it now, which, to be expected, but it's really cool seeing that pay off. And just personally with the continued reading row improvement, like as a user myself, like it's been so much help, so helpful. Like, and I think there's so many more things that we can do and will be doing in the future. So, stay tuned.
It's like a cheaper, better Netflix for manga. I mean, you can't go wrong.
Netflix keeps getting more expensive too.
That's the whole thing. It's yeah.
Shonen Jump is more worth it than Netflix. I'll say it.
I think I probably I do use it more than Netflix. I think I'm trying to think. That's true.
The price of Shonen Jump. The price of Shonen Jump is less than some services have increased their prices recently. So, yeah.
And a lot of it is free. Like, I didn't talk about the most recent stuff, but what is it? $2 and you get the entire catalog. It's insane. I have so many series I need to read. It's just like a little scary how much is available there. Like, I don't even know where to start. There's a lot, and also finding time. But I instead of editing podcasts on trains, I could reach and jump. Before we ran. Oh, Steve, we should also keep going. Steve, where can people find you?
Yeah, I got derailed.
What podcasts are you on, Steve? Besides this one.
This. Damn it.
I cut you off at the legs.
Yeah, I'm on Toon Suite. I'm also on The Deep End. You should know these. And I'm on Twitter and Instagram. You know him.
Steve Urko. All of those. Just follow him on all of the social media. You'll figure it out.
I was just listening to your Outlaw Star episode.
Oh, yeah, me too. Cool.
Yeah, that one was a lot of fun.
That is a great intro. I'm afraid to go back to watch that. I don't know how my opinions of that would change.
It's fine.
I love the designs and the ships and the, that stuff is so cool. But, And the intro.
Fred's fictional, Zach. He can't hurt you.
Good to know. Ed, where could the good people out there contact us?
You're Zach_Logan on Twitter. I am Edward E. One Piece. I'm also at Weeb Trailers on Twitter. You can check out the Japanese trailer for Akira that I posted a few days ago. Yeah. The podcast can be found at onepiecepodcast.com, twitter.com, youtube.com, and facebook.com/onepiecepodcast. onepiecepodcast@gmail.com is our email address. onepiecepodcast is our Skype name. r/onepiecepodcast, that's our subreddit. You can leave us some piece together there. You can subscribe on SoundCloud. You can subscribe on Spotify. Subscribe, rate, and review on Apple Podcasts, or call us on our phone number, Zach.
And that phone number is 347-497-MAJI.
MAJI.
That phone number again is 347-497-6254. Call anytime.
Anytime.
With your questions, comments, theories, or why he should have been called Hiopopotamus. Or Hiorse. I mean, there's so many great choices there. Before we go, we got some
Hyena.
Trivia.
Wait, never mind.
Hyonia. We've got. I think what might be the hardest trivia segment I've done because I'm just an evil, evil man. I am positive I would not get any of these. I'll put it that way. I'm going to call myself out now. I would not know shit. If anyone could win this, though, I think Ed is the most likely to. So at least there's that. Right. So I'm going to, cut some more slack.
Awful, man.
Jeff, I don't know if you've played any of our trivia before, but the way it works is we go around the horn. You have to, I give a category. You name something in that category. If you either get it wrong or not able to name one in time, or name the same one someone else has named, you're out. The last one to survive wins a taiyaki cookie the next time I see them. By the way, who do I owe at this point? I think Ed and Steven are probably in the lead at this point. So we'll go in the same order we went for the manga recap. So it's going to be Ed, then Sam, then Jeff, then Steven, and then Steve. Or no, then Steve, then Steven. Sorry. So you guys ready? Here is the category. Named swords in One Piece.
Ooh,
that's it.
Okay.
Yeah. This is something I suck at. And that's why I am saying this would be the hardest one for me to do. I'd get like two and then I'd be like, I'm out. So Ed, you're going to get first dibs here.
I'll just go with Wado Ichimonji.
Yes. Sam.
Kitetsu the Third.
Yes. Which one? So they do them in Japanese in Wiki. Which one is that?
It's the San something.
Sandai?
Kitetsu.
Yes. If that's going to, that'll give you guys a hint for some more to come. Jeff?
I'm just going to throw a sword in the middle of nowhere at other
that sounds
series. I have no idea if these are in One Piece, but Masamune? Is that a One Piece sword?
I don't think so.
Okay.
All right. It was a valiant effort there. What series are you thinking of, Chet?
Final Fantasy?
Oh, I'm a terrible nerd if I haven't made that clear before. Steve.
Shusui.
Yeah, that is one. Steven.
Let's go with the Nidai Kitetsu.
Ed. Round two.
Yubashiri.
Yep, Sam.
Like, I'm thinking of some characters that I know have named swords, but I don't know the names of their swords.
Gonna give you 3 seconds here.
Yeah,
been 3 seconds. Yeah, Steve.
Saw Blade.
Yeah, what is the? The Japanese, I think, is a different name. I should have written it down. That's the name in English, though.
Arlong's?
Right? Yeah.
Yeah.
That's the Kiribachi, I think, is the.
Yeah. Here it is. Yeah. Black.
I mean, that's what they call it in English, Tom.
Yeah, it's the saw. Yeah. I'm going to take that, Steve. That's fine. Steven.
Let's go with Shodai Kitetsu.
Yeah, I think that's the last of the Katatsus, guys. Ed, round three. It's a ton.
Shigure.
Yeah.
Autumn Rain. Yeah.
That one is that that's Shiryu's? No.
No, it's oh god, I keep thinking of Quina. It's not Quina. It's the other one.
It's not important. no one cares. Steve.
Funkfried.
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
Oh,
that's nice. I was saving that one. Yeah.
Yeah.
Steve, well, Zach, you do know this has been a trivia question before.
All named swords?
Yeah.
Oh, you're looking at the guy who kept track of them?
No, I'm just looking at nothing because that would be cheating.
I don't remember doing this, but we have been doing
I feel like I remember this.
I think we did one with Funkfried, like Zoan, like inanimate objects, maybe. I don't know. Anyway, let's keep going. Steven.
There's Kikoku. That's Law's sword.
Yeah. Oh, now, even if we did, it's still a hard category. that's what I'm going to say. Where did I put it? Kikoku. Kikoku. There it is. Ed.
Mihawk's sword is named Yoru.
Yeah. Nice. that was a weird thought process there. Steve.
No, he was. I was thinking of the line that where he says it. So,
Steve.
What was? I'm gonna say this was when Soge King had to act as a sword when he was handcuffed to Zoro. I'm gonna take a stab at it, if you will.
I don't know the name of that.
Was he called Nosewind or something?
I think you're right. I'm gonna give that to you.
Yeah.
Just because it's Hana super Arashi. Creative.
That's what it was in Japanese. Arashi, is that wind or
no? That would be no storm.
Yeah, no storm.
I'm giving it to you, Steve. That's a really creative answer. And everyone knows that that was a real sword. I don't care what anyone else says. Steven.
Durandal is Cavendish's sword.
Mm-hmm. Ed.
Ooh,
this is way more competitive than I thought it would be.
I might be out. Ohm's Cloudblade.
Yeah, I think I have the name of that.
Here. Is that the name?
Is that the name?
No, it isn't. It's not called Cloudblade. Wait, let me just double check.
It's written on the side.
Cloudblade. No, that's not it. It has a name.
Okay.
Who are we up to? So, Steven, it's the Battle of the Steves. Once again, Steve.
Mihawk's short blade necklace cross sword.
It doesn't have a name, though.
Doesn't have a name. I said named swords. I did say named swords.
It's named Little Mihi.
Do you want to take it? Do you want to take an actual guess?
Shit. One Piece.
So, it's a show about pirates. That's how you recall things. One Piece.
What about it's swords specifically, here. Right? It's not sword, bladed weapons.
Swords. Yeah. I mean, the cloud one is weird, but that is a sword. Yeah, so just swords. Yeah.
Swords.
I mean, what bladed weapon are you thinking of, Steve?
Let's go with Kaku's nose, because it acted like a blade.
Okay, Steven, if you get this, you win.
Oh, man.
All you have to do is name any sword and you win.
Any sword. How many more are there?
There's a few. Yeah, I was just looking. Just
three,
swords,
four,
yeah.
Five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11.
And it's all the recent ones that we don't remember.
Yeah, there's some recent ones. I don't know what all these are.
Shit. I feel like I know Shanks's sword, but it's just on the tip of my tongue. I can't.
Oh, yeah, that was recently named. I remember that being in an SBS and being like, they haven't named that yet?
It's called Big Red.
should have been.
Oh, man.
3 seconds, Steven.
I felt, wasn't it something like the Falcon or something like that?
I can't remember.
Okay, guys. So for a tiebreaker, and just say the word buzz, and whoever could get it, whoever says buzz first, or between Steve and Steven, can get it. What is the name of Brook's sword?
Buzz?
Steve?
I don't fucking remember.
No, Humming is his nickname. Hum Diggy.
Okay.
Hum Dinger.
The answer to that was Soul Solid. Let's do another tiebreaker here between Steve and Steven. Right. Okay. What was the name?
Hold on. Can I do a tiebreaker?
Please, Ed.
All right. The sword Pretzel belongs to what character?
Oh, ooh, Cracker. So
there you go. I was going to say the same thing. So, Steve, yeah. I was going to reverse that, but yeah.
Wait, how did Ed get kicked out? Did he get kicked out the same round up. That Steven?
It was the second to last round, yeah. Oh, okay. I was out after...
I think you guys may have each named one.
Or no, character. I guessed Ohm's Cloudblade, but it's apparently called Eisen Whip.
Yep.
Sounds
not
good.
The character from Bleach.
What's Shanks' sword?
I don't know. We got
Griffin. I said Falcon. It was Griffin. Damn.
Oh yeah, yeah. Griffin.
That's close.
Yeah.
And Shiryu's sword is named Ryu, apparently.
Ryu of
is it Ryu or Ryu?
It's R A I U. That's what it's.
Well, what is the Ronin Warrior script?
What kind of Street Fighter kid were you?
You know the name the word for sword is Ken in Japanese. So.
Ooh.
I also have Shiki's if you got, you know, good for you guys. Oto and Kugura.
What was Shiki's called? Left foot, right foot?
Righty and lefty.
I have Terry's sword. Who's
the giant blade.
That's the giant.
It was
Same Kiri Bocho is, what's his name, Bastille's that Sabo breaks?
Oh, yeah.
By the way, Brook sword, Soul Solid. I find it really crazy how, myself included, none of us knew the name of Brook's sword. That feels like it should be something that's like, he only has one, you know, Zoro has three, and I bet you most of us knew all three of those. Four, yeah. He had one, and now he has three. Anyway, I just found that kind of crazy. Kashu? Little Kashu?
Domon Kashu?
Wait, who is, I'm going to look these up with you guys. Oh, that's Toshigi's sword. Actually, that was the
no,
Mr.
No,
11
no, Kashi was the one she got from Mr. 11. Shigure
yeah, that's Mr. 11 sword. Mr. 11's famous sword.
Mr. 11 had a sword.
Charlotte Amand. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah,
what a sword. I'm looking at that. That is a huge sword.
I think that's it. Oh, there's and also movie 5.
Well, I'm not counting fake things.
You said Shiki's. Well, he was
in the manga. And those swords, I think, were. I don't know if they were in the manga.
Whose sword was named movie 5?
If you ask me, that's a pretty lame name for a sword. Okay, that's going to do it for the One Piece podcast. Next week, we'll be back with special guest from Crunchyroll, Daniel Dockery Returns. And hopefully we will have some announcements specifically on our Patreon in the next week or so. So please keep an eye out for that. And yes, I am making an announcement for an announcement. That's how that works. Anyway, we'll see you, next week, everyone, with our manga recap for chapter 940. But until then, my name is Zach.
My name is Ed.
My name is Steve.
See you next week, everyone. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Bye.
You want to see my sword, huh? Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Do that stuff. Do it. Oh, yeah, yeah. I'm out of here, y'all. Peace. Tim, did you get that? Tim, did you get them? So, as Kawamatsu's doing his Kappa dance, of course, Hiyori also wants to do the dance, and he says, only I may dance. that didn't happen. That was a joke targeted only at Steve. I just think it's funny that he's like, oh, the princess is so devastated. I must cheer her up by dancing. She's like, oh, wow, that's so sweet. I'll dance too. No, you stop.
Only Kappas may dance.
Yeah, this is our dance. You don't have to dance.